Kalahar. And I'm very happy to welcome you here. It's really great to see all of your faces. Next year, hopefully we'll be back seeing them in person. I'd like to introduce our panelists. I'd like to have them each introduce themselves briefly. We'll start out with Dr. Haiyan Chen.
Hi, everyone. I'm Haiyan Chen. I'm a professor in computer science, data science from Willamette University, which is located in Salem, Oregon.
Hello, everyone. I'm Deepa Mirza. I'm an associate teaching professor in computer science at UC Santa Barbara.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dana Chogut, a professor of computer science at University of Central Florida.
Hello, everyone. My name is Gloria Washington. I'm assistant professor at Howard University, located in Washington, D.C.
Hi, everybody. I'm Barbara Ryder. I'm an emerita professor at Virginia Tech.
So, Kim, you may be on mute.
Kim, you're muted. You're muted, Kim.
Sorry about that. You'd think I'd have this down by now after a year. But I just wanted to mention to everyone that those first four that introduced themselves were the 2021 Mentoring Award for Undergraduate Research, the Maurer Award recipients. And then Dr. Ryder, so that's an undergraduate mentoring award. And Dr. Ryder is the Harold and Notkin Research and Graduate Mentoring Award recipient for 2021. We also had a lot of people working with me behind the scenes, and some are on the call today working as well. Dr. Nancy Amato from the University of Illinois Champaign-Urbana. She's the first recipient of the Harold Notkin Research and Graduate Mentoring Award in 2014. So she's here helping us today. Jen Rexford from Princeton was a 2017 Harold and Notkin Research Mentoring Award recipient, and she helped us a lot on the behind the scenes. She's not able to be here today, as is Katie Seek from Indiana University. She was a 2019 Maurer recipient. And we have Gretchen Achenbach here today, who's at NC WIT, and she's helped us along with Beth Quinn, the Director of Strategic Initiatives for the Academic Alliance. Terry Morreale, she's our president and CTO. She's today's tech support behind the scenes. And Susan Roger from Duke University. She's a 2020 Maurer Award recipient, and she's today's moderator. So I'm going to go ahead now and turn it over to Susan to start our panel.
All right. And so it's great to see everyone. I see all kinds of names I recognize. Sorry, we can't be in person. We're going to start today's mentoring panel by hearing what the 2021 award recipients would like to share with you. And I'm going to start with Dr. Ching. How many mentors and what type of mentors should a student have?
I don't think there should be a set number. In my opinion, the more the better if you can manage. However, you got to think about what kind of advice you want to get from whom. So it totally depends on your need and the stage in your life. I think as a student, one definitely needs an academic mentor who can provide them curricular guidance, research directions, and career advice, because this person is academically established and has broad experience. So in some cases, this role can also be split into several people. And I remember the advice I was given when I was a student was you should have advisor from people from different disciplines, from different gender, from different ages. And that applied to me really well, because in the end, I listened to everyone, I synthesized their recommendation, I know my options, but in the end, it's me who choose decision, I make decision for myself. I think it's also important for one to have a life mentor who can help making major decisions. So basically think of what kind of advice you can get from which person, and totally use your network.
Okay, and how do you inspire students to be lifelong learners?
Usually, I try to encourage students to figure out their passion. I found it's really easier if they know what they want to do, and then they tie their goal with their learning, and then also they figure out their learning styles. What's their best way to learn? Because learning doesn't only happen in classroom. We have to constantly maintain curiosity, ask good questions, learn from life. So I encourage students to seek how to apply what they have learned in classroom and everywhere, and then to create something. So if the learning process can be fun, if they know what they can build and what they can accomplish. So I'm trying to inspire them to do that. And then also learn broadly, not just limited in their own discipline. I often, when I teach, I share what I learned from watching Netflix or other movies or even listening to NPR. So I like to, science excites me. I want to inspire my students to learn constantly.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Ryder, what are your goals for guiding graduate students into a research career?
So my main goal is really to prepare a graduate student so that she understands what it takes to be a successful researcher. And I believe that students learn by doing. So I'll give you my list of things that we try to do in my research group. First of all, you have to create an environment where students learn how to learn together. They read papers, they evaluate them, they ask questions about them, and they talk to one another about them so they can learn from each other. I think that's very important. And they also learn how to communicate well as part of that when they're explaining things to one another. Then you teach students how to look for support for research claims, not to criticize everything they read, but to try to make sure there is some evidence for the claims that people make in their papers and that they're clearly explained. And in doing that, you're helping to teach students how to verbally and in writing explain their own work clearly, which is very, very important, and to be accurate and not exaggerate what they've done. As a student gets more senior, gets more experienced, you try to point students at less well-defined problems so that they have to independently kind of frame what it is, frame the question as to how they're going to answer it or what they're going to try to do to investigate that, because that becomes very important to them in their final research career. And for students that are getting to the end of their studies, you really should challenge them to think about a multiple year approach, not to look at just small problems, but to look at pieces of problems that might end in answering something truly, truly significant. An important thing for you as a mentor is really to include students in your ancillary activities. You're writing proposals, you're presenting at conferences, you're giving advice to people. Senior students can advise more junior students, for example, in terms of problems they've encountered or experiences they've had that may help them. And you should show by your own example that it's important that we each give back to the community, like this, like appearing on a mentoring program taking a responsibility in one of the professional organizations, for example. It's something I've done in my career, and I'm very proud of it. And maybe the most important thing is to share why you followed a research career in your life, why research, being a researcher has been joyful for you and frustrating at times, but really is a good choice for people who are like yourself.
Thank you. And how does mentoring benefit both the mentee and the mentor?
So clearly a mentee benefits from the experience of the mentor. Everyone doesn't have to go through the same experiences. They can learn from others about things that are roadblocks or problems. And I also think the mentee can benefit by being led to ask the right questions when looking for a research topic to explore, for example. And sometimes when you're working on a team, there are interpersonal problems that develop or you get blocked in your thinking. You've thought and thought and thought about the problem. You can't go ahead. And these are really common problems. But of course, everyone thinks it's only them that has them. So mentees can learn from a mentor's experience in such things. The other good thing is that a mentee learns that mentors don't always know. They don't always have the answers. And this is common in doing research. And you just got to get used to that. You got to deal with it. Now, the mentor also, I believe, becomes a better communicator And whether you're explaining things to a mentee or trying to figure out how to criticize something they've done in a way that will encourage them to improve it as opposed to feel discouraged that they did it wrong, if wrong exists. And for myself as a mentor, I have always gained in knowledge from my mentees, my graduate students, exploring areas that I knew a little bit about, but certainly didn't know the depth that I achieved after exploring them with them as they gain in their in the depth of what research they're going to do. And it really helps the mentee to understand the state of the art and the mentor in many times. So I've broadened my knowledge through my mentees. And I think overall, the mentor really has the satisfaction of making some contribution to the advancement of knowledge, even though it might be in part through their mentees. But by watching the successes of their mentees, they can gain a great deal of satisfaction in their profession.
All right, thank you. And Dr. Turgut, I have a few questions for you. What do you most want to say based on your experience of mentoring?
Thank you, Susan. It's a pleasure to be here today. Basically, over the years of my career as a faculty, I had the opportunity to fulfill several different types of mentoring roles in many different situations, starting from mentoring undergraduate students in their transition to research to mentoring individual students on their honor theses, which also has a significant research components. So for me, the question is, why am I really championing mentoring, right? Certainly, many students can potentially succeed without mentoring, especially if they had previously learned how to navigate a complex organization such as a university. However, more times than less, we see way too many students who clearly have the capability to succeed in a certain program, but they just simply don't know how to make the most of the educational opportunities of a given program or the ways in which to avoid the pitfalls, right? And this is, I believe, is mostly, especially true for first-time in college students or international students, for instance, freshly coming to US to attend an undergraduate institution. So I would say you need a mentor because the body of knowledge necessary to succeed in a certain field is often not available in a written form, right? So while we're talking about the technical knowledge in the field, like computer science is important and is certainly well documented, it's significantly harder to acquire what we call the soft knowledge necessary to succeed in any organization. And of course, there are a lot of books about this, right? So you can read many books about this, but you notice that this advice is going to be often very general and it's not, and it might be too, or it could be too specific to a certain organization. So I would say the advice a good mentor can give a student is specific to the student's circumstances and especially organization in which they actually hope to succeed.
Okay, and what should others learn from you about mentoring?
Okay, I would say that my first observation is that a successful mentor should and must pay close attention to the background of the student, right? This is not only about the academic preparation. And in fact, most of the students, for instance, in my RU program, are generally well prepared academically. However, they were coming from diverse backgrounds and sometimes from institutions where, which is very different than large research institutions like UCF here. So one problem that keeps occurring is that they needed mentoring was to understand the change in the student and faculty relationship when they were transitioning to research. What I mean by is that most students are generally familiar with only with the faculty as an instructor model, right? As a faculty, we lecture on a topic that we know all the answers, we give assignments, we grade the answers and so on and so forth, kind of like what you know, Barbara was saying earlier, so we know the answers, right? When we teach courses, but when it comes to research, not everybody knows the answers ahead of time, right? Even the mentors. So as a result, the students basically had to become more familiar with the fact that the research team is pursuing questions that maybe no one knows the answers ahead of time, even the faculty mentors. But of course, if you have more experienced members of the team, they can provide more significant insights. So usually for me, mentoring is usually means that figuring out together whom the student should ask for help. It's not always going to be the same person. For instance, is this particular question something that a student needs to figure out themselves? Or is it better if she asks for help, and whom does she need to help ask help? Like, is it going to be a lab mate or a peer or a graduate mentor or a faculty mentor, or is it an IT technical support person, right? So in the context of the RU cohort, for me, in addition to collaboration and research groups in which the students are assigned, my efforts are also many times are directed towards setting up these informal knowledge networks within the cohort of the RU students.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Washington, I have a few questions for you. Mentoring students is a lot of extra work. So how can you convince other faculty to take on mentoring? And do you have advice for them on how to get started in mentoring?
So I like to say that faculty, when we think about it, are already mentoring while they're in the classroom. And sometimes students cannot picture them as students. And so to humanize themselves, they need to truly think of when they were students. So specific examples, like I always relate a challenging time that I've had in a computer science class. And this is just for everybody. In my first computer science class, I got a D in the class. And so it devastated me. So I took the class again and actually got an A in it. But I talk about the experience as to taking responsibility for the things that I did in getting that grade, but then how I was able to get the better grade in the next semester. And then also, I also am an academic advisor. So anyone who comes to my office, I'm automatically putting on different hats as both a professor, but then the advisor. So what I'll do is relate my experiences with the classes that I had when I was in school. And I may look young, but it was a long time ago. But it just humanizes me as a person. And so then there'll be more apps who want to come to me and say, hey, I'm really interested in either in your class or in learning more information about a particular element of computer science. So can I work with you? So that's how I've been able to finagle and get some students interested in wanting to know more about undergraduate research, but also incorporating the mentorship in my teaching.
Okay, and how do you connect with students when you mentor them?
So it is very important in my research group that we have both sort of professional development sessions and then also sessions where we talk about the research process. So I'll go through, we actually had someone from the lab, an alumni who won the National Science Foundation Graduate Research Fellowship. So we'll have a professional development session over that. Well, how would you even go about even starting to take something that you're interested in and turning it into an actual proposal that would be submitted to NSF. And then also we have these sessions where I call a Kiki session, and it's just truly that we can put out any personal information or struggles that the students are going through throughout their day. It's very important that the advisor and just the person who's doing the mentor, that they kind of see you as a human being who is listening to the things that they're going through in their life. So those kind of Kiki sessions allow the students to talk about what's going on in their life. And I actually get, it helps me actually understand the way that they talk to each other, what's important to them. And then sometimes I can also take ideas from that and turn them into proposals for stuff that I would never even think of.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Mirza, I have a few questions for you. So how do you get undergraduates interested in research earlier, say as a sophomore?
So most sophomores don't know why they might want to get interest, might want to get involved in research. And so I tell them This is an opportunity to work on real-world problems and learn from experts. And that gets them excited. But the idea of working on an open-ended problem with the professor is intimidating. And so I need to somehow reassure them that faculty are friendly, that they will be well supported, and that they can actually balance coursework with research. So to help with the messaging, I have former students share their experiences about early research. And what I find interesting is that even the students who didn't seem that much into the research at the time speak from a positive perspective. So they talk about how the research opened doors for them and how they now feel more confident in approaching professors.
Yeah, that's really good to hear. So also, what are the challenges and opportunities of mentoring students in a team-based research experience?
Right, so I should preface this for the audience that I run a team-based research program for early undergraduates at UCSB. And I think that the biggest opportunity is the peer support. So it is normal for students who are new to research to feel lost and overwhelmed, and they're comforted by the fact that their teammates are in the same boat. The other big opportunity I see is that this is really great practice for them with having technical discussions, something that's really important in research, but we don't get that much practice in the courses. And so when I mentor students, I encourage them to, for example, build on each other's ideas when they're having these technical discussions. So I would say most teams work very well. Sometimes they don't, and it's usually one of a couple of reasons. Barbara mentioned some interpersonal problems. My other top three are communication problems, time management, and also when the students in the team have very different levels of confidence, I would say. But you know, having mentored teams for a while now, I feel that the challenges become more predictable. And so it is possible to actually prepare the students and even present the challenges as learning opportunities. So I would say overall, team-based research has more opportunities than challenges, especially for early undergrads.
Okay, thank you. All right, so now what we're gonna do is I'm gonna ask our mentors some more generalized questions. So the first one is, mentoring is labor intensive. So how can you design mentoring so it's scale and be sustainable? And Dr. Washington, could you go first?
Yes. Yeah, so mentoring is very labor intensive. So what I do is utilize either the senior undergraduate students or graduate students that we currently have. And sometimes some of the more junior undergraduate students, they want to develop more of a relationship with some of the senior students. So what I do is leverage that and set them up with mentor buddies. Oftentimes during an undergraduate career, some of the senior students are assigned like a freshman buddy, but they really don't do as much as they should with the opportunity to mentor that person. So with the research lab and having a mentor buddy, they actually work with them on like finding papers or work with them in understanding like different things that go on throughout the department. So I make sure I leverage the graduate students and some of the senior undergraduate students.
Yeah, that's great to be leveraging that. And so Dr. Mirza, also, how can you design mentoring so at scale and be sustainable?
So I would say that at UCSB, we have had considerable success with running a team-based mentoring program that is designed to scale, the one I mentioned earlier. And it is an expansion of the Early Research Scholars Program that was originally created by Dr. Christine Alvarado at UC San Diego. And I think it has three interesting features that make it scalable. The first is that students and mentors can connect easily because we recruit and match them in a central way. And the second I would say is that students in the program take a research methods course that teaches them foundational research skills. And they do that right before they dive deeper into their projects. And the third feature is that the mentoring load is shared between a technical mentor who provides more project-specific support and a central mentor who is engaging all of the teams and tracking their progress. So we've also studied this dual mentoring model. And we found, looking at, you know, what the students say about it, and we found that the students describe the mentoring roles in a complementary way. We've also seen very little attrition in implementations of this program in multiple institutions and across multiple cohorts. So I think the ERSB model is interesting and a good model that scales well.
Okay, thank you. We're gonna move on to another question then. The question is, how do you instill the culture of mentoring in people that may not see themselves as mentors? And Dr. Ryder, could you answer that one?
Sure. Well, for a few years, I participated as a co-PI in a multiple institution NSF-funded program on peer-led team learning. And this was put into CS1 at all the different, at all the eight institutions. And what we did was we chose experienced students who had taken the course, the year-long course, the year before or 2 years before, and set them up as peer mentors for groups of students who were in this year's CS1. And on purpose, we chose these peer mentors from groups underrepresented in computing, minorities and young women. And basically, these peer mentors were doing auxiliary education. They went over extra exercises and related problems to what was going on in class. They did not go over to homework and say, this is how you do the homework. They were there to give more depth knowledge on the topics that were being covered in class. But to a group setting, which we found made it easier for the students to ask questions and to explore things, even if they made comments that were not correct. So this whole thing, the process was that we had weekly peer mentor meetings with myself. I was the faculty in charge, and this was duplicated at all the different schools. And this gave the mentors not only a chance to work on ideas for what they would present in the next week, but to get advice about situations that happened in class with some of the students and to learn from one another how to handle those situations. It turned out that this peer mentoring experience proved really as valuable to the mentors as the mentees. We were able to show through statistics gathered across all the schools that the mentees definitely performed better in class than the non-group mentee students. But the mentors themselves gained a lot in confidence of their knowledge in CS, of their ability to explain things to a group, which they called in public, you know, and they acknowledged that this personal growth, which they hadn't expected, was because of their experience. And subsequently in the department, we've used peer mentoring as a way to maintain and increase our number of young women in the department, for example. So it's a very valuable experience to the mentors. And the word got out. Other people learned about it, and then they wanted to be mentors, okay? And that's sort of increased the coolness of being in this group.
Yeah, that sounds like a great program. I was actually part of that program too. And I agree with everything Barbara just said. It was very valuable. All right, so I also just wanna mention that if you have a question for our mentors, if you could put your question in the chat and you can see Nancy Amato's message in there, just make sure you preface it with the word question so we can find the questions. And we're gonna ask a few more questions and then we will take questions from the audience in a few minutes. So our next question is, how do you get students excited to continue their education? And let's see, Dr. Ching, can you go first?
Sure. Because I'm teaching in mainly undergraduate liberal art college. So lots of undergraduate students, they had no idea what research is like. And then often when they enter the college, they have no idea what they want to do after they graduate. So one of our roles is to help them to make a plan for after graduation. There are many options. Some of them want to go to industry, and lots of them actually are intimidated by going to grad school and continue their education. So besides a supervised individual student to do research, I gradually added into a research component to my upper level CS classes, where students develop team project. They got a taste of what research is like. They can actually propose exciting questions, problem, and try to solve. So during that process, they get exposure, and later on they continue to develop their interest. Another thing I try to get them excited is to tell them all kinds of cool things happen in grad school. I kind of often reflect to my experience where you can meet interesting people, meet people not from your own discipline. You can meet people internationally. And oftentimes the people you meet at grad school will potentially change your life path. So there are lots of more opportunities in graduate school. A practical way to get students excited about continuing their education is to encourage them or take them to conference. So during conference, they kind of identify their role model and understand what the life will be if they continue to grad school. So I think that helped them a lot to widen the variety of their career options ahead of them, and they can be better prepared to continue their education.
All right, thank you. And Dr. Turgut, how do you get students excited to continue their education?
Sure. In my opinion, I think the students actually need mentoring to and the entire support for the whole span of their academic career, in my opinion. But of course, there are certain points where the influence of a mentor can actually make an even more significant difference for the student's future. So one of such situations, in my opinion, is sophomores. And I think Deepa explained that earlier on with the team-based research. And I totally agree with that. I mean, sophomores are generally taking challenging classes. They worry about their next exam. And they may not quite necessarily realize like how exciting the STEM and computer science and engineering fields can be. And I think it's our duty to remind them that, right? So my approach again is very similar. I would like to involve them early into practical and socially relevant projects. For instance, we have a lot of projects ongoing on smartphones, assistive devices for elderly, so such that they feel like they're contributing to the overall well-being of people. And a second important junction is about the decision to follow up their degree and how, you know, applying to graduate school. So I see that many students, and as again, I'm going to go back to first generation students, they are generally considered that obtaining an undergraduate degree is all they are capable or all they must have. So they usually see themselves as employees, and I think it's important to remind them that they can move further down in their, you know, in their careers. So, and of course, there are always multiple ways to achieve this particular goal. So for instance, one can, you know, develop projects in undergraduate classes such as software engineering that have flavor of research. And of course, you know, dedicated programs such as the NSF REU program that I lead is even, in my opinion, more valuable in this respect. And I think it's similar to what Barbara was saying with his program. I think that made really a significant difference in their lives.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I'm gonna, again, encourage people to put questions in the chat. I'm gonna ask one more question, and to think about questions you have, we'd be happy to answer questions. So I'm gonna go on to, we have a long way to go to increase the diversity in computing, especially with underrepresented students. And you've been hearing about successes our mentors have been having with women. So now let's hear about underrepresented students. So how do you recruit and mentor underrepresented students? And Dr. Washington, can you go first?
So for me in recruiting students, naturally, I teach at a historically Black college in Washington, D.C. So we have about 76% Black students. So for me, it's really getting them to want to do undergraduate research. So I have to show them how what they're learning applies to their life. So specific examples, I had an undergraduate student that has a company now called Curl IQ, where you take a picture of your hair and it'll recommend hair products based off of your hair texture. This is very important in the African-American community, and anyone who has curly hair that is Frizzy. So like what she did was actually take my human computer interaction class. And then I also had her take an undergraduate research class where she got credit for that. And then we wrote a paper and did like a poster on it. But that's an example of how I showed them this thing that you want to do. You can do it with computer science. You just got to find a way to show them in interesting ways how it applies to their life. So you really got to meet them where they're at and understand the things that they're excited about and passionate about.
Okay, and Dr. Mirza?
So I usually recruit students into research towards the end of their first year. And so by then they have taken a few classes with me. And so I really try to do some groundwork in those classes to build a positive relationship with the students, especially underrepresented students. So for example, when they come to office hours, I try to turn that into a mini mentoring session when possible and just talk about things that are outside of coursework and you know, talking about work-life balance or anything else that's on their mind. Another thing that has, I think, proven fruitful is that we have more underrepresented students in our peer mentoring program that is essentially our undergraduate tutoring program, similar to what Barbara mentioned. And so I try to connect those students, and most of them have been in the research program as well. And so I try to connect those students with the underrepresented students in my classes so that they can learn more about research from role models. I think role models are really, really important. And so I cannot emphasize connecting underrepresented students with role models enough, really. So these two programs have reinforced each other in this way in terms of recruiting underrepresented students.
Okay, yeah, that's great. And then Dr. Turgut, how do you recruit underrepresented students and mentor them?
Okay, so for underrepresented students, it's really not as difficult for us in some ways because we are also actually, UCF is an HSI, so we have quite a few undergraduate students in our department already in university. But for other type of underrepresented students, I generally try to reach out to institutions that I know people. And for instance, we send out like, a mass emailing list to ERC, for instance, to recruit students. And so basically we do, and I also do a personal, you know, connections to the chairs of various institutions. And I was just telling Gloria the other day that I was reaching out to some of her, you know, some of the chairs in her institution. So those are some of the individual based ways in which trying to get students to consider joining our undergraduate research program during the summer. So I would say, and also I think one way is to get them interested is also show the successes of the previous students who participate in the program. And I think that really, you know, excites them. They go, okay, if this person who looks like me, talks like me, walks like me kind of thing can do this, so can I, right? So it's really very, very helpful to see the previous successes so the students feel empowered that they can do the same thing.
Okay, thank you. So we're going to now go to your questions, and we have Dr. Nancy Amato is going to, she's been monitoring the chat, and she'll answer the panelists some of their questions, some of the questions.
So I think we could first let, I'm going to try to, we're going to let you have the opportunity to ask a question yourself if you're able to. So first is Laura Dillon. You had a question and a follow-up. I think you could ask them both at the same time.
Sure. Barbara, great to see you. I was wondering about your peer-led team learning. I'm assuming that you probably pay your undergraduate mentors, and hopefully you do. I'm wondering how it gets funded. Does the university pay it? I mean, it's come out of your teaching assistant things in the department, or do you have some external funding?
So Lori, and Susan, correct me if you wish, because you were also a co-PI. My recollection, this was over 10 years ago, and the program continued after I left Rutgers for about 5 or 6 years. I don't know whether it's continued now. This is when I was at Rutgers. And we did not pay them money. I think what we gave them was some kind of independent
study credit because it represented time they had to spend, you know, that they had to spend on computing. But I will definitely check that out. Okay. And this was sponsored by NSF. It was, as my recollection is, it was a 3-year grant, right, Susan?
Yes.
You recall? Yeah. And then we had to write a, you know, a big study. We gave it over to people who did statistical. They gave out questionnaires to the students who had participated. But Lori, I'll find out for you because I have all the information about it. I merely just don't remember.
Yeah. We did actually pay our UTAs, like we paid them like UTAs essentially. So because they were working with classes, you know, helping students, and every university kind of did it differently.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, we did a similar thing for many years. And we called it the computational thinking lab, but you know, I felt it was very important to pay the students because otherwise many minority students can't just give their time, right? They have to work an outside job or something. So if you really want to, you know, include diverse mentors, then you really need to be able to pay them. And yeah, I don't know of a sustainable way of doing that.
Right, so they either got paid or they got credit. Yeah, at different institutions, yeah.
That's what I remember.
Should we move to the next question? So Mihai, would you like to ask your question?
Yes. Thank you so much. It's a great conversation. So my question relates to the situation where students are not doing well in the program and trying to figure out how to best understand when they would need additional support to be able to be successful and when it's really something on the side of the student that they're actually not meeting the goals, the research goals, and so on. So how do you navigate this space? Because I think these mentorship programs are at some level meant to support the students, but there's also situations where the students themselves are not actually putting in the effort to be able to succeed. And I'm not sure how to, I always err on the side of being too nice, and I think that's bad too.
I guess I can start answering that question. For the RU program, we are basically having a weekly research progress meetings every Friday, where the entire cohort gets together and they actually present their accomplishments that they have that week. They talk about their issues, if they actually solve their issues, what were the solutions so they can share with other students and their plan for the next week. And so that actually creates a synergy between the peers, between the students themselves. And I see that a lot of times, if a student finds a solution to one problem, it actually applies to many others as well. So that's sort of like one way of making the students accountable for the week that they work. So if they feel like they haven't done much and other people have done a lot more, that kind of makes them like, oh, I better do some more work next week, right, type of thing. And of course, because it's a funded NSF program, we do expect other things from them. Like one of the things is that we have them do a poster presentation, which we call it RU Symposium, which is a very formal event where they spend days preparing their posters, practicing the presentation. And a final thing is their report. And I usually have them write reports in a very professional way. We have LaTeX template given to them. And we also go through midterm or mid-program progress reports where they actually start writing their report, but they continuously get feedback from the graduate mentors and faculty mentors and so on and so forth. So in RU, I think one way, and I think that's not just for RU only, but I think if you can also have hierarchical mentoring, I think that could also be very helpful. So they could have not only peer mentors, but mentors from graduate students and mentors from faculty. So I think when you put those things together, generally they usually do a good job. But I can understand your question, Mihai, because it's kind of hard if you don't actually fund them. It's difficult to have the expectations on that.
So we have now a couple questions that I think it would be good to kind of pose and maybe respond, ask the panelists to respond to them together. Liz Johnson has, I think I'll just read them in this case, has said, we're considering having older students do code reviews with our CS2 students, first hardcore core programming class in the major. Do you think this is a good idea and should we do it as a group, like one mentor to several students or individually one mentor to one student? And then Jiasi Chen asked, Any thoughts on graduate students mentoring undergraduate students? Sometimes I find there's a culture communication gap that makes it hard for the partnership to work well. So I think that we could kind of maybe think about responding to those questions, you know, together. Who would like to take a shot?
I'll take the first question, the code reviews. We actually did something like that in my CS2 course. And then we also added into the mix where the person who is considered the weaker programmer would have to retype it. And with the feedback from the person who is considered the more senior person doing the code review. So that actually worked out really well for them to understand what they were missing or not thinking about when it came to a solution.
So in my university, we also have group leader strategy. So like one student overlooks several students, and we also have the option of one-to-one. So both structures at the same time.
Anyone else want to, panelists want to talk about those?
So the part about the graduate
students, I'm having trouble with my audio.
The part about the graduate students mentoring the group of undergraduate, I think that can work okay, but I think the graduate student has to understand they're not a teaching assistant in that situation. They're not grading the students. They're there to help the students learn how to do something, to lead them in accomplishing some goal. And there has to be, somehow you have to make it so that the graduate student understands this is a skill they need as a researcher, especially if they're going to be an academic. And then I think things can work out. There's always exceptions to every rule, but that's what I would do.
I would add to that actually we use graduate students a lot in our undergraduate research program, and it's been really great to have the graduate students talk to each other once in a while to share mentoring strategies. And so that really helps them get better at mentoring. And I do agree with Barbara that I feel graduate students are more excited sometimes about mentoring in the research context than maybe in teaching. That's been a good experience, I would say.
Yeah, what I wanted to get to, Barbara.
I intended to actually put three questions together. I was having a little bit of trouble with my audio. So maybe you'll want to comment on this too. This was a question from David Merritt. To increase female participation in a CS program, does the mentor need to be female? If not, are there different strategies to take when the mentor is not a female? So maybe if you're, the rest of you can think about that, but now go ahead, Donna, sorry.
Oh, okay, I wasn't thinking, okay. Let me see what I can think. I think my initial answer, no. I don't think you need to have a female mentor to mentor female students. I think you need a good mentor who understands the students, what the student needs are, right? So for me, I wanted to also say that the students are not going to be a perfect mentors right from the get-go. So I think they need some level of, experience and also maybe a little bit of a sort of maybe attend a workshop to see how, you know, what does it mean to be a good mentor, a research mentor, right? So I think we need to provide that to our students, whether it's undergraduate mentoring undergraduates or graduate students mentoring graduate students. But I mean, if you can find a female student who can mentor female students, I think that could also go a long way, but I would not say that it's an absolute must. And so really you want someone who enjoys mentoring and who can listen and tweak their ways in which to fit that particular individual student, because not every student is coming from the same cookie cutter, right? Everyone is different. Everyone learns differently. So I think the mentor needs to adjust their skill set in that respect, in my opinion.
Anyone else have something to add to that kind of set of questions, suite of questions? We're good? Oh, Barbara, go for it.
So about this business of having to have a female mentor, I agree that I don't think the mentor has to be female, but I think it's also important that you look at the environment. If there are no women professors. If there are few women undergraduates or graduate students older than this female, then the female student is in a different environment than if there are plenty of women professors, which of course is nowhere, or if there are several female graduate students. So I would encourage someone mentoring who is male and mentoring females in that situation to seek out maybe some of these kinds of role model folks and see if they'd be willing also to at least talk to the female student and make her feel as though she is more welcome in the environment. Not that he can, but it helps to have a few females that the person feels less alone, less of an example of a singleton.
Okay, we have just like 4 or 5 more minutes left for questions, and then we'll kind of come back for the parting tips. So I think we have time for maybe 2 more questions, but let's try to keep both the question and the response brief. So James Vanderhyde, would you like to ask your question?
Sure, hello, thank you very much. This summer I'm going to be mentoring 3 research students at once. I've never done that many before in a summer project, and I wonder if you have any ideas for like structured, informal or formal activities that I can do with them.
So for multiple students, usually I start with drafting the proposal, the plan. So I have them to make sure the clear expected deliverables, timelines, and the goal. So we have lots of meetings to talk about and brainstorm in the early stage. And then each student need to identify their role. So in this proposal, they need to clearly identify what, how, and when, and who. Very specific. And then they keep making this research journal progress. So during the research meeting, sometimes they report their progress, but most of time, you know, you worry about running out of things to talk about. Sometimes I ask them to contribute. They give lecture to me. So when they learn, I think the best way to learn is to teach other people. So instead of learning, they can also contribute knowledge. So I give them a general topic, and they go explore to find the resources, and they even produce lecture slides. So if they can clearly communicate the result to me, that means they understand better. Sometimes I learn from them. So I think that will kill lots of time. I give them major tasks to learn and then ask good questions from there.
Thank you.
One other recommendation would to also have them do a research blog, like you said, journal, where it could be a website so they can keep track of weekly what they did. And usually that works for my students when you're mentoring more than one.
The other thing I would say, take them to lunch occasionally, do social things, you know, and try to build a team that way too. It's important.
So is Jerry here? Would you like to ask your question? This will be our last question from the audience.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for taking my question. So we're encouraged to keep track quantitatively of how much mentoring we do in our annual review. So I'm wondering if any of you have tips, tricks as to a blog is a great idea, a self-blog, or any other ways that we can keep track of the multiple mentoring roles, functions that we fulfill every day, it seems.
So just informally myself, we use Asana project management, and it also will track, you can assign tasks to different individual students underneath it. And you can, if you want to, on the calendar, put when you have the meetings. So you'll know how many hours, you'll know how many hours you spent in thinking about even writing up their milestones that they need to put for the summer. And from the student perspective, they can also communicate back and forth with you and ask questions about specific things that you assign them to do. But Asana is really good. And then there's other free ones out there, but Asana just works well.
Okay, so we're gonna stop with the questions in the chat. We are gonna go back to our mentors one more time. But before I do that, I just wanted to mention that there is a link to a survey in the chat. We would appreciate if you could fill out. And there's also links to resources in the chat. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to ask each panelist in 1 minute, so we have to be quick, do you have a mentoring tip to share with the audience? And let's start with Dr. Ryder.
Okay, mentoring really is about aiding another person to achieve their goals. Hopefully your guidance helps. The most important thing you can do is be a good listener, be patient, and be accessible to your mentee. And sometimes it helps a mentee sufficiently just to voice a concern to a sympathetic listener.
All right, thank you. And Dr. Mirza, your tip to share with the audience?
I would say we really want to encourage our mentees to ask questions. And so it's important to build a rapport with them early on, because I feel they engage better when they sense that the mentor is interested in their well-being, primarily above everything else. And I would also encourage that failure is okay, and that use failure as a means of getting to better ideas.
Thank you. And Dr. Washington, do you have a mentoring tip to share?
Yes, utilize senior level undergraduate students. They are rarely given genuine opportunities to mentor. And if they're given the opportunity to mentor the younger students, it kind of helps communicate the struggles that you have with communicating with them and getting them to keep on task and do the things that they need to do. So it shows them how to really be a good leader.
Okay, thank you. And Dr. Turgut, do you have a mentoring tip to share?
Sure. I would say that do not start giving an advice right away. As Dr. Ryder mentioned, I think mentoring should start by very careful listening to students, what they have to say. And because every student is unique and they have their own challenges, that I think a mentor needs to be able to respond to accordingly.
All right. Thank you. And Dr. Ching, your tip for mentoring.
Mentoring takes patience and lots of work, but it is rewarding. Spending time to get to know your mentee really helps to customize the research content and build a better mentor-mentee relationship. Mentors play a role of inspiring, empowering, not enforcing. So it is really important to help mentee to reflect on their academic strengths, personal strengths, and align their strengths with their research goals. I think having the communication channel open and help mentee solve problems and train their problem-solving skills have a long-lasting effect.
All right, thank you all, and I'll give it back to Kim.
Great, thank you all for attending. I'd like to thank our panelists. They spent a lot of time working with us in the last month or so on this panel, hopefully to ensure it was wonderful for all of you. A lot of people that work behind the scenes, especially Nancy and Susan, who were on a call today and you both saw. All of you for taking time out of your busy schedules to attend today. I hope that you all decide to become more involved in mentoring now that you've got some excitement going and some guidance here. And of course, our sponsors of these two terrific awards, the Board of Directors was the Harold and Notkin Research and Graduate Mentoring Award sponsor since 2004. And AT&T has sponsored the Mentoring Award for Undergraduate Research since 2012. And I'm happy to announce that they're both refunded for 2022. That's always not an automatic thing. So I'm always happy when they do participate again, especially in today's odd climate. Today's session was recorded. It will appear on our NCWET webpage soon. I'll send you all these attendings a list of the potential mentoring resources and a link to the evaluation. They were both in the chat if you didn't have a chance to grab them. And please consider nominating yourself for the Maurer Award. A student can nominate you, you can nominate yourself, you can nominate a peer. That information will be available later this summer. The Harold and Notkin Research and Graduate Mentoring Award has to all be completed by the nominator. So look forward to seeing the materials later this summer, opening up for our new awards. And I hope that you all enjoy a break this summer and that you're able to return to some type of normalcy in the fall. So thanks again, and we'll see you all. Stay safe.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.